Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Teleclass Panel Discussion for AS Chemistry. I am Fatma Cherilin from Center for Higher Secondary Education. Please introduce yourself.
I am Ms. Benita from CHSC.
I am Mr. Jitesh from Ahmadiyya International School.
The purpose of this panel discussion is to clear doubts the students might have after they have seen the first teleclass that was aired on 1st of April. The topic discussed was based on formulae, equations and the amount of substance. I've also highlighted some of the important aspects that students need to acquire in mathematical skills during the course of the 2 years. The topics that I went through mostly include mole calculations, calculations based on reactive masses, limiting and excess reagent, percentage yield, and atom economy. So I have received some questions based on these that was discussed in the class. So before going into these questions, Ms. Benita, can you tell me why some students find these chemistry calculations very difficult?
AS calculations, A-level calculations.
Yes.
Well, it's not like O-level calculations, because in O-level calculations, most of the questions are very direct. But in A-level calculations, most are application-oriented. So they need to think about how to apply the formulas and where they have to apply the formulas. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I find even we have a 1 minute duration for each MCQs.
Yeah.
And very hardly we find like a calculation with one step. So within that short time, they should like list the stages, how do I proceed. And they have to like distribute the time, only 1 minute they have. So they have to divide that to 3 or 4 steps. So most of the case, students might get stuck in one step. They might have thinking whether I should do this way or that way.
Okay.
That thinking will make more than 1 minute. So in a overall version, like if I have 6 to 7 MCQs with a calculation, it takes most of the MCQ duration. Then they hardly get a few minutes for the other questions. So that's also a reason like students might think drop the MCQs with calculation first and start with the other part. Later on what happened, they do like simply circle few MCQs.
Okay. All right. So we have got some questions from our students as well. Now the first question is, what is the total number of atoms in 2.7 grams of water, H2O? So would you mind answering that question?
So I think better I will try then.
Okay. All right, sure.
So like the question is about how many atoms in 2.7 gram water. So remember you have a molecular formula of water, and from the formula it's very clear there are 2 hydrogen atoms and 1 oxygen atom in 1 water molecule. So students should first remember total 3 atoms in 1 molecule of water, but directly we have no relation with atoms and mass. So we have to step. But you know that everything in our calculations some way connected with mole. And here you have a mass in gram. So we have to use the relation between mass in gram and mole. So we have either in a ratio way or using a simple formula, you can easily get how many mole water in 2.7 gram H2O. So I think, but I display it here. So we are going to find how many moles in 2.7 gram water. So if I use the ratio method, you know that 1 mole H2O is actually of 18 gram. The 18 gram per mole is the molar mass of water. So you can find, so how many mole is in given, that is 2.7 gram. This is the first stage. Okay, so it will give you, I think,
the moles of water.
Moles of water. And once you get moles of water, we have a second stage, that is, we have a relation between Avogadro constant and mole. And in that relation, it says, if you have 1 mole of a substance, there is 6.0 into 10 to the power 23 molecules. So the first stage calculation, you are getting how many mol? And now we also have a relation stage 2, we relate mol with molecule, and using this you can find how many molecules of water is there. And in step 3, you know that one molecule actually have 3 atoms. So this answer you substitute here, cross multiply, you are getting an answer. Okay, this is the way you actually get an answer for this question. The answer must be 2.7 into 10 to the power 23. Okay, so that's what I mentioned at the beginning along with the miss, that just one mark question, but we have step 1, step 2 and step 3. So this, if you are so good in this calculation, you can easily assume like without these steps you can get to the final answer. But normally for an average student, they should try step 1, step 2 and step 3. It's a time consuming procedure. Okay, I got you understood. And the answer for this question is 2.7 into 10 to the power 23 atoms. Okay.
Thank you. Now, I hope students have understood how to work out the number of atoms. We also have got a question with regard to number of ions that are present. Normally, these calculations relating to molecules and ions are a little tricky. So, let us see the answer for this question. Calculate the total number of ions in 7.41 grams of calcium hydroxide. The molar mass is given and the Avogadro's constant is also given.
Yes. So just like the first question, this is also exactly like the same. So usually for Avogadro constant calculations, the 3 steps you have to always follow. First step, find the moles of the compound. So if it is moles directly given, you can skip the first step, or else you have to calculate the moles. Second step, find the moles of the chemical entity. What is that entity means? What they say in the question, whether it is atoms or ions or positive ions or negative ions, whatever it is mentioned in the question, you have to find the moles of that chemical entity. And the last step, you have to find the number of that entity. That is, you have to multiply by the Avogadro constant. The last 2 steps you can swap, as that is sir discussed in the first question. You can just swap the last 2 steps. So in this question, the steps are: first, to find the moles of the calcium hydroxide. The RMM of the compound is already given. So mass over molar mass will give you the moles of calcium hydroxide. Second step, find the moles of that chemical entity. What is the chemical entity mentioned in this question? Number of ions. In 1 mole of calcium hydroxide, we have 3 moles of ions, 1 Ca2 plus and 2 OH minus ions. In 1 mole, that much ions present means in the first step answer how many present, that is the moles of the ions. But the question is concerned about the number of ions. So just to multiply that answer by the Avogadro constant, you will be getting the answer for this question. I hope it would be useful.
Yeah. Thank you. So one thing that we find is, like sir has said, students have very limited time in doing multiple choice questions, and also we do see a lot of multiple choice maths questions there. So what would be the best way for a student to answer or tackle those type of questions?
Yeah, first of all, they have to practice the questions by putting the timer. So the timed practice is a must for the students to tackle all those questions, because time is very, very less, and not like other subjects. In chemistry, we have 20 MCQs always and 30 minutes for 20 MCQs. So unless they are very thorough with the content and practice with the time, it is very difficult to tackle those questions. Otherwise, you have to go with inky-pinky-ponky stuff. There is no other go.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I think they also should know, the first time in grade 11, they do like separately mole atoms, mole ions, number of ions. So students usually don't get the basic difference. There are situations like they ask to find mole atoms, so they will directly multiply with Avogadro constant. But in MCQs, there will be a guideline. If They can even assume if no Avogadro constant is provided, you don't go to that far. But most of the time in reality, that they don't actually get the difference between the mole, atoms, ions. In there are some questions even to find electrons even collected, connected to mole. Hmm. So they don't get the basic thing that suppose they have mass number and atomic number, they know that the proton number, electron number, neutron number, but still they get confused with the basic mole thing. So their basic content knowledge must be very, very, very good to just to even like happily attend an MCQ of this kind.
Okay. So thorough practice is the key to answering these MCQ questions, right?
Yeah.
All right. We have got a third question. A sample of sodium chloride was heated and 120 centimeter cube of oxygen was collected. Calculate the number of moles of sodium chloride that were decomposed in the above reaction. So molar volume is given in the question. So
I think I can just say the guideline, but I prefer like to show you the status.
Yeah,
okay.
Sure.
So like this question is a bit different. The last two we stick with the molecules, ions. So this question starts with volume of a gas. That also the volume is in centimeter cube. So first of all, the student who read the first line should know I have a gas and its volume is given, it's in centimeter cube. So they should first recall we have a relation between mole and volume, and we have a term called molar volume, both in a centimeter cube and also in dm cube. So here you start, always we have to somehow get the mole. It only will help you to find proceed to the final stage of the calculation. So here you have a volume, so first you have to start calculating how many moles of oxygen gas is actually collected, in other way how many moles in 120 centimeter cube. So again I prefer to use the ratio because this relation is so easy to understand. If you have a ratio, one mole of any gas at room temperature and pressure, it is actually 24,000 if it is expressed in terms of centimeter cube. So we have actually 120 centimeter cube of gas. So you have to find how many moles of oxygen. This X stands for moles of oxygen. Okay. Now we found the first part, and now we don't have so many steps here. We just have to use the basic ratioing. Okay. Here the actual question is to find how many moles of the reactant sodium chloride 5 there, which is actually required to form this many moles of oxygen gas. So we are going to the equation. The equation must be balanced. As it is an MCQ question, the equation is actually balanced. So we are going to check the ratio between sodium chloride 5 and oxygen. So we have, as you know, sodium chloride is NaClO3. We have oxygen. And then the ratio, it's just the left side number is the molar ratio number. So 2 moles of sodium chloride you need just to get 3 moles of oxygen. So we have, this is the ratio from your equation, and now we found how many moles of oxygen actually there. So we have a ratio, so we are finding how many moles of oxygen here. So you get an answer for moles of sodium chloride. So your answer for this question, I think it is 3.33 into 10 to the power 3 moles. So we are substituting this answer here, you're finding this one. So we are going to cross multiply to get this number. So that must be 3.33 into 10 to the power minus 3 mole. Okay, I hope you understood the actual path, like finding mole and relating with the equation and the molar ratio. Okay.
So it's a two-step process.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Shall I give you a one-step process for this one, for the smart kids, those who are very good in mathematics, this one? So because the time is very limited for the MCQs, so I'll go with the shortest method. So here, in this question, the balanced equation is given with the, there are three components given in that equation, but the question concerns about only two compounds, which is sodium chloride and oxygen. These two compounds are mentioned with the two different entities. That is, what are the data given for this? These two compounds. For sodium chloride, it is given in moles. Oxygen, it is given in the volume. Okay. Now use the ratio. According to the balanced equation, 2 moles of sodium chlorate is giving 3 moles of oxygen. So sodium chlorate is in the moles format, but oxygen is not in the volume format. So you are multiplying this by the molar volume, 24,000. That is, according to the balanced equation, 2 moles of sodium chlorate is giving 3 times 24,000 of oxygen. But we need to calculate how much moles of sodium chlorate needed to produce 120 cm cube of oxygen. So to produce 120 cm cube of oxygen, what would be the moles of sodium chlorate required? This is just a simple step, a direct calculation. Those who are following the normal step also, you can use that one. But those who are very good in mathematics, you can follow this one. Just multiply this one, 2 times 120, 3 times 24,000 into x. We need to calculate x, just find x. You will be getting the answer.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, if you are having a multiple choice question to answer, it's always good that you follow this shortest method so that it will be easier and you will be saving a lot of time, isn't it? But these are the two methods that you can use.
Yeah.
Any of these methods will be, fine in getting the answer as long as you do it following those steps.
Okay.
Now, in the calculation questions, students tend to lose a lot of marks. Because let's say for example, we have titration questions where there's a follow from the first step and up to the last step, and there are multiple steps where they have to do these calculations. So when do they get these error carried forward awarded in calculations? Like,
I guess if it is stepwise questions, they will be getting the ECF. Because based on your previous answer, if another question is asked, based on your previous answer, you are doing this one. The next question, if your following question method is correct, based on your previous answer, then they get the ECF.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, do they get the full marks for that?
For the wrong answer, no mark for that.
Okay.
But for the final method, for the final one, they get the
marks. Get the
marks. Right.
All right. So, within the question, there's no way that they will get any error carried forward?
It depends on the question and the marks as well. If it is one mark question, probably no mark too.
No
but
mark.
Yeah, if it is more than 3 marks or 4 mark question,
I think recent 2020 paper, there was a 5 mark one.
Yeah. That is why A2, I guess, for the big questions, that is the whole question will be asked. But in AS calculations, most of the questions are stepwise calculations. So probably they will be getting more marks in the AS.
Okay.
ECF will be given.
Because some students are really worried about losing all the marks the entire question is based on one simple concept, and then they tend to follow the same calculation and then get multiple wrong answers, and they fear that they lose the mark. There's a good news that if you follow the correct steps and then do the wrong, if you get the wrong answer, you still get the error carried forward mark, so that you get that rest of if your method is correct, so you get the rest of the mark.
I have another. Suppose we solve this question. A student suppose forgot to multiply it with 24,000. Suppose it is a section B question, not an MCQ. And students forgot to multiply with 24,000.
Okay.
And they just multiply with 24. And they found them all, and they are getting the final answer. In that case, how do the students get the mark? For the same kind of a question. Okay, they got the same question. But it's not a multiple choice. It's just a descriptive type of question. And even maybe it's a 2 marks or 3 mark question. So the same thing they are doing. A student forgot just to find them all using 24,000. And they use 24.
TMQ.
And they got a mole, and the same mole they used in the second stage to find the other mole. Suppose the final question is, say, in gram. They also found that in gram. So, 3 steps they proceed. But only one mistake that student made. The first step, instead of 24,000, they used 24 DMQ. In that case, how these marks will be?
I guess for the first step, they will be losing the mark because
remaining two steps according to the current statement, the steps are correct, method is correct. Their first mistake, they will neglect that step's mark, it will be gone. I think remaining 2 steps, they should get the full marks, right?
Yes, because
so they
the
will
student
not get
followed
the maximum
the
mark, right? Okay. But part of the marks will be awarded to the correct mark.
Correct.
Yes.
All right. Another question. that we have, since we are dealing with calculations here, students have sent all calculation questions. So this question is talking about an important reaction which occurs in the catalytic converter of a car, and the equation is given. In this reaction, when 500 centimeter cube of carbon monoxide reacts with 500 centimeter cube of nitrogen monoxide at 650 degrees Celsius, so the operating temperature of the catalyst is given in 1 atmosphere, the total volume of gases produced at the same temperature and pressure is?
All right. In this question, usually when more than one reactant data is given, first step you have to fix which one is the limiting reagent. But in this question, all are equal. Mm-hmm. That is, mole ratio equal and the volume used up is also equal. So the student can use either carbon monoxide or NO. Any one compound they can use to find the total volume of the gases produced. So just like we discussed in the previous question, there are two ways you can solve this question. First, the normal method. First, to find the moles of that compound, volume over molar volume, using that volume, find the total, what is the mole of the total moles of the gases produced. Then the total moles of the gases, you have to just multiply by the molar volume again. That is the usual method. Or you can just use the logical method, just like this, just carbon monoxide or NO with the products, just to find the moles and then find the volume of the gases produced.
Okay. I think if students identified the ratio, mole ratio and volume ratio is equal, they can even directly go for the ratio 4:3.
Okay.
So 4:3 also, 4:3 also they can use, no? So you can 1000 is to
in
X.
One reactant, no? We have to use.
If they have found the total volumes equal, volume ratio and mole ratio is equal, they can even go for an extreme way, like 4:3, 1000 is to X, 750, still they get the answer, I think, for this combination.
Okay, because
everything is equal.
Okay.
And I think in this question, they have to be very careful because students are required to find the total volume of gases because both are gases. And if they forget to actually include nitrogen in the answer, then most probably they will get it wrong. So it is tricky because total is highlighted in bold. So that means there is something important. So it is important that they look into these keys that are given in those questions.
And moreover, in this question, they didn't specify the molar volume. That means that is the clue given to the student. That is no need to use the molar volume in this question. They can just use the logical method to work out this question.
They can just use the volume ratio, mole ratio to find the answer.
So if they do this calculation correctly, they will get it.
Just it is 2 moles giving 3 moles means, then that is 500 would give how much? That's it.
So answer would be 750. Okay. Next one is, what are the common mistakes that we find like in chemistry calculations? What are the most commonly seen mistakes in these calculations?
Common mistakes usually, that is, if the question says show all the steps, show all the working means, sometimes the students forget to include the steps, and sometimes the in-between answers, that is a rounding of that answer, that is
most of them
so
do that.
Wrong.
Most of them do
do not round it off that answer in between. That is especially to one significant figures, and moreover, the final answer, how to express the final answer, how many significant figures or how many decimal places they have to use, just they have to check with the question. For example, if the question asks about what would be the concentration of one of the reactant or product, what is the concentration mentioned in that question? How many decimal places is given in the question? Better to express the answer with that number of decimal places. That would be the best answer. Even though a range of answers are given in the marking scheme, but the best way to express the answer is just to check up the question, how many maximum significant figures or decimal places given in the question, express with that one. So that would be, I think, in that places the students go wrong in that one. Then anything else?
Usually that kind of mistake, they do round off. I don't know, somehow they start believing
round
that
off.
Okay, round off it.
Round it off and give
yeah,
the final,
give it
answer.
Final answer. Okay. So that even we repeatedly say that don't do that, don't do that. But still somehow in a calculator, so many digits are there. They have a like habit of making it short.
So main thing is giving all the steps.
All
yes.
The steps.
And then getting the correct significant figures.
Yes.
Not a not rounding off within the. Within the question.
Yeah.
All right.
In some case, I found like if a 3, 4, 4 steps are there, they don't actually specify what is step number one.
Okay.
We hardly find, okay, this is this calculation, that is this calculation. They just calculate, just list here and there and get an answer.
Yeah.
So I usually ask them, either you right side you say this is the mole of this, or left side you say we are calculating mole, or you keep a heading, moles are these underlined.
Just put a number.
Number.
Steps, yeah,
they
exactly.
don't do, like, especially for 5-mark question, I think it's important that at least a person who marks, they should know this is the step. This
exactly.
is stuff, but there you usually forget it. Just like randomly here and there, they just list the answers. So that also we have to advise them. We do, but still they do the same kind of mistake.
So their presenting answer is also an important aspect of actually scoring the marks, right?
Yeah.
So they need to actually lay out it in such a way that the examiner can understand what the student has done.
Okay.
All right. So I hope students, you are actually taking these into account. You should be able to write down the answers in a logical manner so that the examiner can mark, can understand what is given, and also you should be able to identify the number of significant figures from a question, and you should also not be rounding off your answers in between your calculations, right? Okay, so we have another question. So in this one, we are asked to give the, there are two parts to the question. So carbon monoxide and oxygen react together as follows, and you are given the equation. If all volumes of gas are measured at the same temperature and pressure, the volume of carbon dioxide produced after 50 centimeter cube of carbon monoxide react with 50 centimeter cube of oxygen is. So that's the first part of the question, and the second part is what volume of gas will be remaining in the reaction mixture if the product mixture pass through an aqueous sodium hydroxide solution.
Okay, so I think first part is just similar to the previous question.
Okay.
Almost the same. Before we had the same volume, same ratio, but in this case we have the reactants actually follow the ratio 2:1.
Okay.
So everything is in a volume term, everything is in centimeter cube, the volume. So you can just follow like the first step as Miss mentioned, find which one is the limiting reagent here. Okay. And the carbon monoxide and oxygen, two reactants we have, and follow the ratio 2:1. That means since everything in gas term, mole ratio you can just relate with the volume ratio, because you would divide with the same 24,000 to find the mole. So here 2:1 is the ratio. That means 50 centimeter cube of carbon monoxide need only 25 centimeter cube of oxygen. Okay, that means your carbon monoxide decide how much product is formed.
Yeah.
We have excess of oxygen. Okay, so you can drop that part. Oxygen is of useless to us now. So we just follow that 2 carbon monoxide forming 2 carbon dioxide. So 2:1 ratio. So 50 centimeter cube of carbon monoxide should form 50 centimeter cube of carbon dioxide. Okay, so the answer must be 50 centimeter cube.
Okay.
And the part B is like from a recent paper, I think 2020, you have similar question this way, and you're passing this reaction mixer, means you have a mixer of carbon dioxide and unreacted oxygen. So in this case, 50 centimeter cube of carbon monoxide need only 25 centimeter cube of oxygen. Okay, so there will be 25 centimeter cube of oxygen remaining, plus as you calculated before, there is 50 centimeter cube of carbon dioxide also. So a mixture of 50 centimeter cube carbon dioxide and 25 centimeter cube of unreacted oxygen, that mixture you pass through aqueous sodium hydroxide. Carbon dioxide is acidic, and sodium hydroxide is an alkali. So when you pass an acidic gas like carbon dioxide through an alkali, that alkali will take up the entire carbon dioxide. What remaining will be only oxygen. So the question is, what volume of gas remaining? Only gas remaining is oxygen. Carbon dioxide is gone now. So it will be just the 25 centimeter cube of oxygen. Okay, so that way you solve this kind of a question.
Okay.
A similar one actually is in 2020 paper. Okay.
Yeah. So I think in the second part there is this point that they have to understand that aqueous sodium hydroxide solution is alkaline.
Yeah.
Okay.
Unless they know the concept of acid-base reactions, they will not be able to actually work this out.
Yeah.
Even though they know the
True.
Calculation method,
yeah.
right? So in calculations, apart from the mathematics that is covered, there's also chemistry content that they need to understand, especially in questions like this where they have to know what happens when sodium hydroxide is introduced or when the gas is passed into sodium hydroxide and that carbon dioxide is an acidic gas, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else that you would like to add?
No, it's
fine.
Good.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the second part's answer is 25 centimeters.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this kind of a question, I think 5 or 6 times the same pattern question is in your previous year papers, but not logic is same. Like you should find sometimes some gas will be unreacted from the reactant side. The students will directly calculate what moles of product is formed or what volume of product is there without noticing that some gas or some reactant is left over. So they will ask, what's the final volume of the reaction mixer? So they might forget that some unreacted gas is already there, and they should sum up it. There is some ozone question kind that, there is some sulfur dioxide question is like
it
that.
It is very frequent.
One. Okay.
They have to just to keep that in mind, that is what would be the volume of
unreacted
reactant. That also they have to include for the final
answer.
So, those questions that they have to work out, the total volume of gas remaining will include whatever that is excess that is present in the reaction, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, another one. A sample of gas was prepared. All calculations that we have got are gas calculation, volume calculation. A sample of gas was prepared for use in helium neon lasers. It contained 4 grams of helium and 4 grams of neon. What is the ratio of helium atoms to neon atoms in the sample?
Yes, well, this question is exactly like an empirical formula calculations. Instead of 2 different elements in the same compound,
two different elements
are given, that's it.
Okay.
So just first they have to find the moles of helium and neon, that is
then
just like the ratio method, then find the
whole number ratio.
Whole number ratio, that's it. That means volume, gram mass over RAM, relative atomic mass of helium and mass over relative atomic mass of neon, they get the ratio, mole ratio, just they have to make it as the whole number ratio. So they will be getting the answer, I guess, 5:1 ratio in that one? Yeah.
5:1.
So,
yeah, 5:1. First helium's mass divided with its RMM.
Yeah.
The neon's mass divided with the RMM.
Yes. Helium and neon, and both their masses are 4 grams. Helium RAM is 4, and neon relative atomic mass is 20. So it is 1:0.2 ratio. So when you are doing the empirical formula calculation, you know how to multiply. If you are getting 0.2, you have to multiply by 5 to get the whole number ratio. If it is 0.3, multiply by 3, 0.4 times 2, just to the nearest whole number. You can't just round it off that value. So using that method, just to multiply this by 5, they get 5:1 ratio. Yeah.
Can they divide by 0.2?
It's also the same thing. And first, remember, both are monoatomic. That's why our calculation is so straight. So helium also is monoatomic, neon also. Suppose you have another thing, so far they don't ask, no?
Yeah.
So this is kind of easy MCQ, that's why they may be like.
Yeah.
mainly those calculations that require larger, set of, you know, arrangements of different steps will be more complicated,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, I think this question number five that we have is talking about, in an experiment, 1.2 to 6 grams of potassium chlorate was heated. A mass of 0.3 to 0 grams of gas oxygen was produced. It was collected. Use the molar mass, it's given, and relative atomic mass of oxygen is also given, and it's a percentage yield question here in this the production of oxygen.
Yeah.
Second one, it's what is the atom economy? I think if you have gone through the teleclass for this, I did discuss
well explained
about
yeah
the percentage yield and also atom economy. Maybe that's the reason we have got this question.
Yeah.
All right. So,
shall I?
Yes, please.
So this one, we have a similar one we solved before. In that question, it was about volume terms. Okay, it was asked to find how many moles of sodium chloride 5 is there. So in this case, it's just opposite. You should calculate percentage yield. You can have a step-by-step calculation. I prefer to do that. I think Miss will later come up with a shortcut. Okay. So like you have in this question, please remember, you know the mass of the only reactant. It's 1.226 gram of potassium chloride 5 is there. So first you can find how many moles of KClO3 is there, and they don't make any trouble. If you without calculator, most of these mole calculation you can do. So in this case, the mass and the molar mass actually have some relation. Only the you can check that. So 1 mole of KClO3, its mass is given 122.6. So we have 1.226. So you can find how many moles of KClO3 is there. So this value, so easy, no? Right? It just because the number and molar mass both have some, only the decimal difference only. Okay? So you can find the moles of KClO3. Then you move to the second stage, like 2 moles of KClO3 is forming 3 moles of oxygen. So you know the answer. So you can find how many moles of oxygen is there. Right? Then this is step number 1. Step number 2, where you are relating KClO3 moles with oxygen mole. And in step number 3, you are finding mass 1 mole of oxygen, actually of 32. So you are finding what mass is there in your calculated mole. Okay. So third step, I do agree we are making 3-4 steps, is an MCQ question, but just to know, this is the step by step path. Okay. Now first step, you are finding the percentage yield. So it's actually the calculated mass of oxygen is here. Okay. And you have also in first part of the question, it's also listed that how much is obtained. So the ratio percentage yield is actually 0.320 divided by, you get 0.480, that into 100 you get the final percentage yield, and it's actually 66.7. So when you learn this topic, it's very clear. I think the last class Ms. mentioned what are the factors usually will affect the final yield, how do you improve the yield, which method you choose to get a better yield, and other related use of a catalyst for these kind of things. But here we don't use it anything like that. That's the way you calculate percentage yield. And the part B, it's percentage atom economy, no connection with any of this calculation. Okay, it is just using the molecular mass of the reactant and the product, and just a balanced equation for this process is enough to get the percentage atom economy. In this case, it asked to calculate percentage atom economy of KCl. So you have a formula for calculating percentage atom economy, that is total molecular mass of the required or the desired product. And from the equation, it's very clear 2KClO3 actually is forming 2KCl and 3 oxygen. So percentage atom economy is total molecular mass of the product. So it must be 2 into 74.6, that is the total mass of the product form, the required product, over 2 into 74.6 plus 3 into 32. This ratio will give you the percentage atomic economy, and the answer is given, it's 60.8. Okay, I think the recent papers actually have 1% yield or atomic economy calculation. Yeah. It's there. Okay, I think you understood. I think any more about this topic, I think we will discuss it now.
Yeah.
So, what is the difference between percentage yield and atomic economy?
Atomic economy is how much amount of useful products they are getting from the reactants. Yeah. That is atomic economy. Mm-hmm. But percentage yield is how much reactants are giving the products. Okay. It, no need to worry about that is whether it is useful or not. Okay. So how much amount of the products are formed from the reactant is percentage yield. Atomic economy is among the products, which compound is useful for us, how much amount is produced, that is atomic economy. That's the difference between percentage yield and atomic economy. And moreover, for these calculations, first of all, it's better to memorize the formulas, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, percentage yield is the calculated mass over, you know, the given
experimental
mental
actual
yield
over
theoretical times 100.
Yes.
Yeah.
And for atom economy, it is
the RMM of the desired product
over
RMM of either they can use all reactants or
all
RMM
products.
Of the products, anyone they can use.
Into
they get
100.
Answer, into 100.
So, which one do you think is better, percentage yield or atom economy?
Nowadays, atom economy is more concerned because the resources are limited.
Oh,
so, when you choose an industrial manufacturing, we should actually aim for something which will not make much of waste. So it's always a big concern, how much is the atomic economy of process. I think the other part we can improve, like if you use a very modernized technique, if you use
catalyst. Yeah.
And percentage you can improve, and however good you are, however better your process, still the yield is not going to be that 100%. But if you choose a particular reaction which give less product, less wastage, so it will improve. It will benefit in terms of the resources, limited resources we have. So I think atomic economy is a more important term nowadays compared to percentage.
Yeah, because we are going into more greener processes.
Yes,
right? We need to make less waste, and we need to make
compromising conditions
to make this world a better place.
Better place.
Okay. All right. So this one is dealing with percentage error. Okay, tolerance of a 25 centimeter cube of pipette is plus or minus 0.06. The percentage error in measurement of 25 centimeter cube using this pipette is.
I think the first time, I think the new specification, we have more detailed version of this error in our book.
Yes.
And even sometimes some calculation also is a bit different, like multiplying the individual uncertainties, and some students find it's very hard just to get it.
Okay. So first of all, to answer this question, they need to know the formula for this one to calculate the percentage error. The formula is uncertainty over the measurement times 100, or the error over measurement times 100. So in this case, the uncertainty is already given, that is 0.06 cm cube, and the measurement, how much they are measuring, is also given, that is 25 cm cube. So it's just like zero, just a direct substitution, 0.06 over 25 times 100. All right. In which cases, they have to multiply the uncertainty values by 2. There are three apparatus in A-level courses, they have to multiply the uncertainty values. Those are burette, thermometer, and the weighing machine. Because why we have to multiply by 2, by the way? How many times you are using that apparatus to make that measurement? That many times you go through that uncertainty. So that many times you have to multiply that one. So if in the question, if you get burette or thermometer, mostly burette or a thermometer. Because energetics calculation, we use a thermometer measurements.
Yeah.
And for the burette, for the titration calculations, yeah, we get a burette. So for those two apparatus, how many times you are using that apparatus to make that measurements, that many times you multiply that uncertainty, you get the answer for this one.
I think it's better you give an expression like total uncertainty over measurement.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they will know that we have a total uncertainty we should consider, rather than just error over measurement. It's better total error over measurement. No? Then they will know that there are some cases we should double the individual uncertainty values.
Okay. So total error. And also I think we have seen in recent past papers that they are asking for the total error because of few instruments that they are using. Let's say for example a pipette and a burette in a titration, and then combined error that they have to calculate. So this is quite a straightforward calculation, but they are expected to know more than that.
Yeah.
So combined, being able to calculate
it's
combined
just quite
error.
Easier. The same way method they have to use first to calculate the uncertainty in pipette, for example, and calculate uncertainty in the burette. If the question asked about the total element, just
there
add
are,
those.
There are even comparison also, which will make more error, which will make less error. And even there are even question like before they used to ask in unit 4. Now I think in front of unit 1 level, how to improve.
How to improve.
It's the first time I found in a unit 1 paper, like it was a temperature measurement. They asked how do you reduce the percentage error calculated. Usually in unit 4 or 5.
So how do we improve?
To reduce the error in the apparatus, usually we have to make the measurement larger.
Okay.
For example, if it is a burette, it is plus or minus 0.05 cm cube, means instead of using 5 cm cube measurement from the burette, make it as a 15 cm cube so that you can stabilize yourself and you can measure the values. If it is a 5 cm cube, very quickly you have to do the measurement, so the uncertainty will be very high. So whenever to reduce the uncertainty in the apparatus, possible to use that is larger values in mass also, that is for example in the temperature change, instead of using the 1 gram, we can use 3 grams of the compound, so the temperature change will be larger, so we can reduce.
And even if you use an acid base reaction, use an acid of a bit higher concentration also will be
instead of the lower concentration, use the higher concentration, so that
so
the temperature
rise
change
will be more.
Okay. So uncertainty will be reduced.
Okay, that's I think a very good discussion on percentage aid and atom economy. And one last question that we have. This is talking about parts per million. We haven't done this yet, but then because we have got this question, we will just go through it. The recommended limit for safe exposure to sulfur dioxide in the air is 0.00025%. What is the concentration in parts per million for this question?
So you're expressing that in million, in 10 to the power 6.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
very
your
calculation.
First part is in 100. So it says 0.000025 is in 100. How much is in 1 million?
So 10 to the power 6,
They can just cross multiply and get it. But there are some questions, it kind of bit of confused one also is in this topic. I think the next class, I think you are going to explain.
Yes.
There are some questions, even first reading you will know, you will not know what to do. But the question is to find express in PPM. I think some part of questions are there.
But don't forget to use all the zeros, because so many zeros are,
so
in, the question.
Zeros are there in the question.
It's more likely to miss any one of the zeros, then the whole answer will go wrong, right?
Now, if the students are to apply the formula of atom economy, how would
atom
they
economy?
Approach? Yeah.
That is
like number of parts over total into 10 to the power 6. No?
Yeah.
In this case, you have how.
Sulfur dioxide in the air,
It's in 0.00025 in 100.
In 100.
You have to find how much in 1000.
So students, you should be able to understand that the substance is sulfur dioxide, and the volume of air, because we are dealing with two gases here.
Solute and the solvent also they can check.
In this one, they are gases, so we have volume of the desired gas over, that is sulfur dioxide over air, and because it is given as a percentage, they have to use they have used the fraction 0.00002 over 100 into a million, right?
Yeah. And I think it's, they should also remember, if you calculate this kind, that both the solute and the solution, the solvent part must be in the same term.
Unit.
Like
unit.
If sometimes they are in by mass, so they should express that in mass. There is a calcium question provided in mole, and the final answer you have to convert to mass and get it. So they should make it to in a same unit both side.
Okay. So those are the questions that we have received so far, and I hope students, you have been able to understand all these different types of calculations that has been discussed today. And thank you very much. If you have any further questions, please keep posting so that we will take them up in the next panel discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.